There's revival and it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart. A Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it? It's the rhythm of a gospel song. Oh, once you choose it, you can't lose it. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. I got an old church choir singing in my soul. I got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I've got a heart overflowing cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. In the valleys that I wander, and it's beautiful. I've got an old church choir singing in my soul. I've got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I've got a heart overflowing cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. Oh, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. Enjoy.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In the questions, your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore.
Darkness, I will follow you, oh, oh. sing. There's a fountain flowing from the heart of the Savior. Bring your sins and all your guilty stains. Let that river of life wash it away.
Banging. let's have a good time. Just do whatever you want. Christ, and for everybody who is streaming in, welcome. I'm glad you're worshiping with us this morning. Now, if anybody feels during the sermon, as though it is kind of rolling around, or maybe is rolling off, don't worry. I found out in the Sunday school that's a natural feeling, right? That during my sermons, it kind of rolls around. So don't feel bad about it. Yeah, that's what they said, Marcy. I don't know. So anyway, welcome in the name of Christ. We got some announcements in the bulletin of which you may want to take note. Now, there's one thing I have discovered, and this is, I get really excited about very simple things because maybe I'm just a simple guy. You know, but simple things really excite me. And when I figure out how to do stuff, I do it all the time. And I'm looking at my lovely wife in the back. Darling, what have I figured out how to make recently? QR codes. I figured out how to make QR codes. And so I'm putting QR codes on everything. You know, it's on our flyers, it's in... and bulletins, I've got them on the dog, all around the house. So QR codes are really exciting. Now, they do have a meaning, a use, and because they take you to a website, of course, QR codes. And you can take your phone and scan them. They take you to a website. Now, if you notice, on the back of the bulletin, there's a QR code on our little Sunday school, day camp announcement. And if you scan it, it takes you to the document that you can fill out, the form that you fill out, to register. So it's useful, right? Betsy, I'm asking you, that sounds useful, right? Absolute good use of QR codes. That's good. Now, if you notice, there's a QR code in the bulletin. And if you scan it with your phone, it'll take you to the passage that I'll be preaching. Now, usually we have it on the screen, but I didn't do my work quite as well as I could have. And so we're not going to be able to show the passage on the screen during the sermon. So if you want to use your phone and have the passage in front of you, you can scan it with this little QR code. It'll bring you to the website that has the passage I'll be preaching. And during the sermon, you can follow along. So, darling, and I'm, when I said darling, I am really glad only one person answered. because I understand when you say that, you run a risk. That's a good use of a QR code, wouldn't you say? Absolutely. Thank you very much. So, anyway, and as it says in the back, we got a vacation. It's not vacation Bible school. It's a day camp coming up. Use this. We got forms out there that you can fill out. You can pass on to other people. We want to get a good attendance. So make sure that you pass this on to people who might be interested in coming. And you can register by using what? The QR code on the back. So that be aware of that. Are there any other announcements that anybody here might have to make? Yes, Barb. Okay, the outreach team will meet on Wednesday evening. We will not have the block party as scheduled on the 12th. That's on the 12th. And but if you want to come and hang out, you'll probably be by yourself. But, you know, bring a hot dog or bring two and you'll be welcome. Make note of that. Any other announcements? Well, what's that? Oh, there we do have a couple of birthdays coming up in the next week. Very important people who are turning the clock, right? And who might these very important people be? Jordan, how 32 years old, a fine age. You know, I still have socks that are 32 years old. And someone else who is turning 33, I'm thinking. No, it's Marty's birthday. So I think it's appropriate, Dad, to play the... Thank you, Jordan. Happy birthday would be a great song to play. Now, understand, if squeezing the two names, that's fine, if that makes you comfortable. I usually say, God bless you, so that it kind of flows. Because more than two birthdays, it really gets hard to shove all those names together. So one other thing I want to mention before we get started, the flowers, the beautiful flowers that are up here, I want to thank the Jody and Jameson family. thank you so much. They were at Jody's dad's funeral service. So thank you for bringing them here to the church. So we appreciate it. Well, brothers and sisters, as God's people, let's worship him together. Okay, it was on the stick. Any filling in. So, but, you know, it's like a well-oiled machine. Do you see it? Okay, because the offertory is on there too. I could hum. Would that be helpful if, you know? And I'll tell you, people streaming, you know, this is. Yes. Hi, Shelley. What? Well, let me explain to you what a cue. You thought I was talking about a food when I said making a QR code?
Yeah, I didn't know what a QR code was.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Well, you know, that's very interesting because I put these QR codes on everything in our refrigerator. Yeah. So now when I'm hungry, I can scan it, and it takes me to a picture on the internet of the food so that I know what I'm eating. Hey, let's go ahead and sing. So don't worry about that, but if you could find it for the offertory, that would be nice. Or Scott, will you found it? Okay. We're good then. We could go ahead, yeah, go ahead and play it.
You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you.
Standing. Let's all stand up and let's sing some songs as we get into the service. We'll start with Sweet Hour of Prayer.
Yeah.
Very good. And while y'all are still standing, let's sing, Open Our Eyes, Lord. Very nice. Y'all may be seated. And ladies, would you come up here and have a seat, if you would, please? That would be outstanding. And Jordan, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Well, my goodness gracious. How are you girls doing? Good, good. Anything, now you're, where are you from? Where do you live?
Brookville.
You live in Brookville, okay. How is Brookville different than Sligo? What's the biggest difference between Brookville and right here? I'm going to come because I can't see y'all. What's the biggest difference between Brookville and Sligo? Or one difference you see? Don't see any difference? Okay. I'll tell you, people in Sligo have a funny accent. I think it's because it's further south from Brookville. I've heard people say y'all around here. Have you heard that before? Y'all? You hadn't heard y'all around here? Okay, going a boot. That's something else, isn't it? Anything interesting happened this last week for y'all? No, nothing new or exciting happened. Well, you're with your grandma and granddad, right? That's pretty cool. What do you get to do at their house? You just hang out. Okay, just hanging out is pretty good. I like the thing around your neck, by the way. That's really cool. What do they call? Do you know what they call that? Yeah, what do they call that?
Chokers.
Okay, chokers. Why do you think they call them chokers? Do you know why they call them chokers? Because I guess if you get them too small, they... Yeah, that would be a bad thing to happen. Hey, now, you told me your names, but I've forgotten. What's your name?
Sydney.
Okay, Sydney. And your name?
Caroline.
That's... Sydney and Caroline, those are both very nice. Those are really nice names. Now, we're going to talk today about prayer. We're going to talk about prayer. And you know what prayer is? You don't know what prayer is? Prayer is, you know what prayer is? What happens when we pray? What do we do when we pray? Okay, you forget. We talk to somebody. Do you know who we talk to when we pray? Who is it we talk to? That's right, we talk to God. when we go to prayer. So when we pray, we're having like a conversation with God, sort of like you and I are having, y'all and I are having right now. You talk to God. And when you talk, if you were talking to a person, what sort of things would you say to a friend? If you were talking to a friend, what are some things you would say to your friend if you were talking to her? Yeah, that's a great thing. You'd say to your friend, how are you? How are you doing? That would be one thing you'd say. What else do you think you'd say to a friend if you're talking? Well, there's a lot of things, and that's what we're going to be talking about. We're going to be talking today about prayer and how when we pray, we're looking at God. That's exactly right. And we're sharing with God some of the things that are going on in our life, some of the things that make us happy and some of the things that make us sort of sad. Because God is our friend, and he really wants to hear what we feel. And so that's what we're going to be talking about. And we're going to use a story. We've been talking about stories about a man. Now, get this. I want to tell you. Get this. It's about a guy who's trying to find a wife for his boss's son. Have you ever heard of anything like that? Nah, neither. It's a story about a guy who's trying to find a wife for his boss's son. So we're going to be looking at that story. It's from the Bible, but it'll have a lot to do with prayer. So I want you to listen. So let's bow our heads, and we're going to have a little word of prayer now. And then, you know, I'm going to give you something to work on that you can kind of do. And then you can head back to your seat. So let's pray. Lord God, thank you so much for giving us a chance to be together. And thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to talk to you. Help us to do it. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Now, what I want you to do, and I'm going to try to get up and move with some sense of dignity. Would you come right here for me? Because I want to say something. Because okay. Turn around, okay? And those are really nice summer dresses, I'm telling you. Okay, and I want, now, have a wonderful, wonderful week. Have a great day. Enjoy your choker. And what do I want you to remember? God loves us. God loves us. Yes, indeed. And you can get crayons from Jordan. Outstanding job. Yes, I've encountered many chokers at home. Has a little different meaning, but that's okay. Now, we come to the part of the service when we have the opportunity to lift our prayers to God. Now, in the bulletin, we got all kinds of it on the back, inside and on the back, all kinds of needs. Are there any particular needs that we want to remember today and into the next week? Or updates on those that are in the bulletin? Yes, how's Butch doing? Okay. Makes a big difference. Makes a big difference. Oh, very nice. Outstanding. So amen to that. Yes. Yes, Tom. Oh. Absolutely. So we want to lift him up in our prayers. Okay, thank you. Yes, Amy. Oh, my. So we want to lift Ron up in our prayers. And Tammy, we need to lift you up in our prayers, right? You're doing better with Lyme's, because Tammy had a case of Lyme's disease that she's still kind of dealing with. So we want to continue to lift you up in our prayers. Yes. Good. Before the service, we were talking, and Corbin saying he's looking forward to, you remember what he's looking forward to? Payday. And I'll tell you something, if you got a job, that's what you should be looking forward to. So we want to give a word of thanks for that. And we certainly want to pray for Jody's family, whole family, sisters and brothers. Have they gone back? Okay. So we want to pray for the family. So anything else we want to remember? Well, then let's go to God in prayer. And I'll open and pray for a little bit. Now, understand, part of the prayer is to prepare us to hear God's word. And so we're going to be confessing. I'll be confessing a little bit so that we're prepared to hear. And then y'all have the opportunity to lift your concerns to God. And then we'll close with the Lord's Prayer together. So let's go to God now in prayer. Lord God, before we say anything else, thank you so much for giving us a chance to be together this morning. What a wonderful opportunity it is, and we certainly, certainly appreciate it. So thank you, Lord, for being with us and guiding us and filling us with your Spirit. We really appreciate it. And in just a little bit, we're going to hear your word read, and we're going to hear it proclaimed. But before we do that, Lord, there's something we need to confess. Even though you've given us access to you, and that access is something that we all know about is through prayer, often we don't use that very much. Instead, we seek to deal with our own issues, solve our own problems, address our own needs, celebrate our own joys all by ourselves. We don't share them with you. And when we keep them inside, when we fail to share them with you, not only do we break that personal relationship that you've given us the opportunity to enjoy, but we deprive ourselves of some things that are really important. You see, when we pray to you, and you certainly know this, we focus our attention on you, and that has a powerful meaning to us. It also gives us the opportunity, as we talk about our joys and our needs and our concerns, it enables us to focus our attention. And that focused attention we can carry with us when we leave prayer, but when we don't pray, we lose that. So, Lord God, when we fail to approach you in prayer, we ask for your forgiveness. And we ask that you encourage us to open ourselves to you, so that we can feel your closeness and we can sort of organize our own thoughts and feelings. We ask this in the name of Christ our Savior. And now in the privacy of our own hearts, we're going to lift up to you the concerns that we see in the bulletin. We're going to lift up to you the concerns that we heard shared. And we're going to lay before you all those needs that weigh heavy on our heart. Lord God, hear us as we pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for listening to us. And of course, thank you for loving us as much as you do. But right now, Lord, thank you for hearing our prayers and responding to our needs. And we know that you will, because that's what you promised. And we've lifted these needs up to you in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, praying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Now, would the ushers come forward to collect our offering? Let's have a word of prayer now. Lord God, thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to lift this blessing to you. Help us to use these, our gifts, effectively. In the name of Christ we pray, amen. Now, I think I have a new, or I'm at least developing, a new appreciation for prayer. Now, before I say anything else, let me be really clear. I've always believed that prayer is important. In fact, it's been really a part of my life for as long as I can remember. Still, given some of the things that have happened in the last month or so, and I am not talking about the bat that was in our house last Saturday, I think my understanding of prayer, of what it is and what it does, I think it's grown a little bit lately. Who'd have thought? Now, to be completely honest, and I want to be real clear about this, the issues that have kind of put me on my knees recently aren't all that dramatic or profound. So I don't want you thinking that it's some big deal, because it's not. As a matter of fact, I know it can't compare with some of the stuff that some of y'all are going through this morning. But you know, these issues have been important, at least to me. In fact, they've been important enough that I find myself doing a little bit more than, you know, those politicians that we see on television, you know, when there's some horrible, horrible crisis, a lot of which they could have prevented if they'd done something. And they're standing up in front of the camera and they say what? "I'm praying for the families." Well, what I'm talking about is a lot more personal than a line in a press conference. And I'll tell you, that was one of the reasons I've been looking forward to preaching the passage we have this morning. You know, about Abraham's servant finding a wife for Isaac. Of course, that's not to say that the other four stories that we've looked at already in this series aren't important, because I certainly think they are. I mean, when we talked about how God called Abram and how we responded, well, that gave us the opportunity to think about how we've been, what? How we've been called, right? And how we can respond. And when we looked at how God promised a child to Abraham and Sarah, that gave us a chance to think about what God has promised us and how he'll keep those promises to us even if we're not all that good ourselves. And then we considered how Abraham sent Hagar and his son Ishmael away. A story that reminds us that even though there are times when we all have to make difficult, hard decisions and choices, we can still trust that God is a God of mercy and compassion. And then last week, we focused on how God commanded Abraham to sacrifice Isaac. And based on that, how we can actually do what God has commanded us to do, which doesn't involve sacrifice, instead involves what? What has God commanded us to do? To love one another as we've been loved. How we can do that, trusting that God is going to give us the ability we need to actually accomplish it. Now, like I said, these stories, and these are the stories we've been talking about, all of them are important, right? At least they have been for me. In fact, having said all of that, when you compare a father sending his son into the wilderness and laying his half-brother on an altar. What we're looking at today really seems small in comparison. Man, this is small potatoes. I mean, on the surface, all we're going to be talking about this morning is Abraham's servant telling the story of what happened to him as he was trying to find a wife for Isaac. That's it. Still, when we look at what he faced, and when we look at what he did, and when we look at what happened at the end, and then apply it all to ourselves, I think we can find some pretty solid direction as we try to figure out what we can do in the face of tough situations. And I'm talking about the kind of stuff that I've been thinking about and worrying about over the last few weeks, and the kind of issues that some of y'all may be struggling with right this minute. Now, that's going to be our focus for the next, 10 minutes or so. And like I said, it all comes from the story about Abraham's servant finding a wife for Isaac. I mean, at the very beginning, this patriarchal employee faced a tough situation, right? I mean, man, he was trying to find a wife for his boss's son. That's tough. Just listen to what it says in Genesis, and remember, this is a servant retelling the story himself. The servant explained, "I am Abraham's servant. The Lord has been good to my master and has made him very rich. He has given him many sheep, goats, cattle, camels and donkeys, as well as a lot of silver and gold and many slaves. Sarah, my master's wife, didn't have any children until she was very old. Then she had a son, and my master has given him everything. I solemnly promised my master that I would do what he said. And he told me, 'Don't choose a wife for my son from the women in this land of Canaan. Instead, go back to the land where I was born and find a wife for my son among my relatives.'" Now, that's the situation faced by the servant. And I'll tell you, I don't know about you, but to call this overwhelming, this job overwhelming and confusing, man, I think that would be an understatement. Good night, nurse. We're talking about finding a wife for a what? What would be a way to describe him? A miracle child, right? The son of a guy that God had obviously blessed with all this stuff, and a woman who'd experienced a truly miraculous birth. And to make it even more extreme, the guy is his boss. Now, talk about pressure. And where there sure seems, as you look at the story, where there sure seemed to be a lot of focus on the what the servant was supposed to do, there's not very much on the how. I mean, how exactly was he supposed to find a bride for his boss's son among his boss's relatives? How was he supposed to do that? And how was he supposed to convince the young lady to do what? Get herself on a camel and go west. As he described his mission, this servant was in a tough spot, wasn't he? And I'll tell you, I think that's why what he decided to do in the face of that situation, man, that's really important. You see, as soon as this servant got to the neighborhood, before he did anything else, that servant, take a guess, prayed. That servant prayed. Now, this is how, in his own words, he described it. "When I came to the well today, I silently prayed. You, Lord, are the God my master Abraham worships. So please lead me to a wife for his son while I am here at the well. When a young woman comes out to get water, I'll ask her to give me a drink. If she gives me a drink and offers to get some water for my camels, I'll know she is the one you have chosen. Now that's what he did. In other words, before mapping out a strategy or before throwing up his hands, Abraham's servant went to God in prayer. And I want you to notice, as he prayed, two things happened. First, his focus narrowed, didn't it? Because that's what happens when you make a request from the one who is both the Lord and God. His focus narrowed. And second, his vision sharpened. You see, as he was talking to the Lord God, he not only expressed what he needed, but also how he might know that it had happened. You see, the girl of his master's dreams would be the one who would show kindness to a stranger when asked. Now, that's what the servant prayed. And I'll tell you, after he'd finished, at that point, he was able to move forward and complete this overwhelming and confusing job that he'd been given to do. Again, in his own words, he said, "Even before I had finished praying, Rebecca came by with a water jar on her shoulder. When she had filled the jar, I asked her for a drink. She quickly lowered the jar from her shoulder and said, 'Have a drink, then I'll get water for your camels.' So I drank, and after that she got some water for my camels. I asked her who her father was, and she answered, 'My father is Bethuel, the son of Nahor and Milcah.' At once I put the ring in her nose and the bracelets on her arms. Then I bowed my head and gave thanks to the God my master Abraham worships. The Lord had led me straight to my master's relatives, and I had found a wife for his son. Now please tell me, if you are willing to do the right thing for my master, will you treat him kindly, or do I have to look for another young woman?" Now that's what happened. You see, with his focus narrowed onto God, and his vision sharpened, now he was able to see God at work, pointing him towards the woman who would be the mother of the next patriarch, Isaac's son. And finally, he was able to do what he'd been instructed to do. You know, to find this matchless match for his master's son. Now that's the story in a nutshell. And I've got to tell you, I really think it speaks to us right here and right now. For example, just like the servant, we face tough situations in our own lives. Do you agree with me? There are times we face tough situations in our lives. And even though I doubt that any of us will be told to find a spouse for our boss, and Diane, I can guarantee you that's never going to happen to you. Yeah. Unless it comes from her. Often the kind of stuff we face is far more personal and frankly far more difficult to handle. But you know, even though the details may be different, I believe the feelings those situations may trigger are pretty much the same. For example, I think we often feel overwhelmed when we're facing tough times. Not unlike what Job felt when he said this to God: "I am sick of life. And from my deep despair, I complain to you, my God. Don't just condemn me. Point out my sin. Why do you take such delight?" Now understand, Job is talking to God. "Why do you take such delight in destroying those you created and smiling on sinners? Do you look at things the way we humans do?" I'll tell you, it is really easy in the face of problems to become overwhelmed, just like it's easy to become really confused. And I'm talking about confused about why this is happening to me now and what we should do about it. Something that the prophet Habakkuk must have experienced when he approached God with this: Our Lord, how long must I beg for your help before you listen? How long before you save us from all this violence? Why do you make me watch such terrible injustice? Why do you allow violence, lawlessness, crime, and cruelty spread everywhere? Laws cannot be enforced. Justice is always the loser. Criminals crowd out honest people and twist the laws around. Whoa. You see, whether it involves concern for ourselves or for others, whether it involves an issue that is physical or emotional, whether it involves enduring loss or some kind of unexpected burden, I think from time to time we all face difficult situations, don't we? But you know, when that happens, I believe we can do the exact same thing that servant did. You see, like him, we can what? We can pray. We can bundle up all those concerns and all those issues, all those losses and all those burdens. And I'm talking about all that stuff that overwhelms and confuses us, and we can take them to God. And I'll tell you, when we do that, when we decide to approach him with all our problems and pain, I think we're going to find that our focus is also going to narrow. As a matter of fact, I believe we're going to be able to zero in like a laser beam on the one to whom Abraham's servant directed his prayers and the psalmist directed his when he prayed. I come to you, Lord, for protection. Don't let me be ashamed. Do as you have promised and rescue me. Listen to my prayer and hurry to save me. Be my mighty rock and the fortress where I am safe. You, Lord God, are my mighty rock and my fortress. Lead me and guide me so that your name will be honored. Protect me from hidden traps and keep me safe. You are faithful, and I trust you because you rescued me. You see, when we make the decision to approach God in prayer, I think we'll find our focus won't be scattered all over the place. Instead, it'll be narrowed down to the one who can actually provide us help. But I'll tell you, when we pray, that's not the only thing that'll happen. When we pray, I'll tell you, as our focus narrows, I also believe our vision is going to sharpen. You see, as we talk with God, I think we're going to find a sense of clarity we may have lacked before. In other words, we'll have a better understanding of where we need to be and how we need to get there. A place that I believe the Apostle Paul reached when he wrote this to the Philippians. I pray that your love will keep on growing and you will fully know and understand how to make the right choices. Then you will still be pure and innocent when Christ returns. And until that day, Jesus Christ will keep you busy doing good deeds that bring glory and praise to God. You see, when we face tough situations, when life becomes hard, and it does, I think our focus can narrow and our vision can sharpen. And I'll tell you, I believe this is going to happen when we pray. And I'll tell you, the reason for doing this is just as important as it was for us as it was for Abraham's servant. You see, I believe the focus and the vision we're going to receive when we pray, that's going to enable us to move forward and to confront those overwhelming and confusing situations we have to face. For example, as it did for the servant, prayer opens our eyes so that we can see God at work and actively moving around us in the world. That's what's going to happen. And even though it may not always be the way we think he should move or the way we expect him to move, God's presence can be just as real for us as it was for that servant way back in the day. As Paul wrote to the Romans, all our thoughts are known to God. He can understand what is in the mind of the Spirit as the Spirit prays for God's people. We know that God is always at work for the good of everyone who loves Him. They are the ones God has chosen for His purpose, and He has always known who His chosen ones would be. He had decided to let them become like His own Son, so His Son would be the first of many children. Now, I believe that's going to happen. And, you know, because we'll be able to see God working all around us, we'll also be able to do what God has called us to do. In other words, regardless of what we may be facing, and it may be all kinds of things, prayer enables us to face those situations as people who are filled with the Holy Spirit. Again, according to Paul, this time in his letter to the Galatians, God's Spirit makes us loving, happy, peaceful, patient, kind, good, faithful, gentle, and self-controlled. There is no law against behaving in any of these ways. You see, I believe this is going to happen when we pray. I mean, just like it did for Abraham's servant, we'll be able to move forward. Now, as I said a little while ago, over the last few weeks, I think I've come to a new appreciation of prayer. But not as a way to change God's mind. I don't believe that's what prayer is. Rather, as an offering that helps us better understand and accept God's will. And I think we can see that reflected in the story we read this morning. You see, as we consider what the servant faced and what he did and what happened at the end, I think we're an awful lot like him. I mean, we also face tough situations. Situations that feel both overwhelming and confusing. And in the face of those situations, we can also pray. Something that's going to narrow our focus and sharpen our vision. And finally, with that focus and with that vision, we're going to be able to move forward. Because prayer enables us to see God at work all around us and enables us to do what God has called us to do. Now, I think that's what prayer offered then, and I think that's what prayer offers now. And we can believe this because we've heard the story of Abraham's servant finding Isaac a wife. Amen. Let's pray together. Lord God, thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to experience your word. Because that's what it is. It's an experience. And thank you for giving us the opportunity to communicate with you. Now, especially when times are hard and we're struggling with life that seems overwhelming and confusing, guide and direct us into prayer. Because it's through our prayer that we can focus our attention on you and see your work around us. Lord God, help us to pray. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. Now, before we stand and close the service by singing something good, right, Dan? Yes. I offer to you all this invitation. If there's anybody here who might feel the grace of Jesus Christ, the love of God, and is interested in how he or she might respond, please talk to me after the service. If you've got a question about the service or the sermon, come and talk to me about that as well. Okay, Scott, let's close the service. Let's sing together, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. That's an old one, isn't it? Before I dismiss you, thank you, Scott, for doing such an outstanding job on the piano. And, of course, Jordan, who's turning 32 later this week. And, Dan, thank you so much for working the board for us this morning. Thank you. Brothers and sisters, go now in peace and be challenged. Be challenged to do exactly what the song you just sang told you to do. When things get tough, when life is challenging and you feel overwhelmed and confused, take it to the Lord in prayer. And to empower this walk, receive the blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And the people of God said, Amen. Amen.
I can see the clouds rolling. I can feel the winds, they try to shake me. I will not be moved. My feet are on the rock. I can feel the water. Solid rock, I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock.